Breaking news, we found a habitable planet.
Yeah, this is gonna be free real estate.
Do you know any habitable exoplanets? Since humans started to look deeper into space, almost every year you can hear some news like,
wow, there is a brand new habitable planet found in 100 trillion kilometers away.
Earlier ones like Kepler-22b, GJ-581g, and Kepler-452b, and recent ones like TOI-1452b. Right now there are dozens of so-called habitable exoplanets confirmed, and almost every one of them gains a lot of attraction. But sadly, I shall say, most of them are not what you may expected. Firstly, these habitable planets are rocky planets that sit right inside the habitable zone of their stars. The habitable zone is somewhere not too hot or not too cold for any planet orbiting around the star, theoretically. For instance, Earth is in the habitable zone of the Sun, but Mercury is not, because the sunlight is too warm there. The definition itself is fine. But it can also be deceptive. Because clearly, a planet is in the habitable zone doesn't necessarily mean the planet itself is habitable. Just like you can say Earth needs a star to keep it warm, but you don't want to change the Sun to Betelgeuse that pulls the entire solar system apart.
Actually, if the Sun is really the Betelgeuse, then the habitable zone should be at? Wait. 45 billion kilometers?
Same for planets, there are way more factors that determine whether a planet is really habitable. For example, even you switch the orbit of Venus and Earth, you won't get a habitable Venus because that atmosphere 90 times thicker than Earth can still make Venus hotter than Mercury. Switch the orbit of Earth and Mars? Same, you won't receive a habitable Mars because most of the water and atmosphere of Mars just simply no longer exist today. Oh, the only thing you succeed in is accelerating the dissipation of Mars's atmosphere because you let it cope with stronger solar wind while the planet itself has no protection at all.
Oh, but maybe you can put Europa and Titan, I don't know.
So let's peel back the cosmic curtain on a few celebrated habitable exoplanets and examine whether they truly live up to the hype.
Kepler-22b.
This exoplanet, located in the habitable zone of a sun-like star, initially sparked excitement. However, a closer look reveals that it's about 2.4 times the size of Earth, making its composition quite different. The potential presence of a thick atmosphere or oceans could turn this seemingly habitable candidate into an inhospitable environment.
GJ-581g.
Touted as a potential haven for life, GJ-581g is situated in the habitable zone of its red dwarf star. Yet, the reliability of its existence has been debated, with some scientists questioning whether GJ-581g is just a
digital hallucinations!
Furthermore, the gravitational influence of the star might result in tidal locking, creating extreme temperature variations on the planet's surface. In fact, almost all of the so-called habitable planets orbiting red dwarfs face the big problem of tidal locking, because they are so close to the star that the star's power controls their rotation, causing these planets to lose their day/night cycle altogether. That's a very different style of geography than Earth. Planets like this include our neighboring exoplanet Proxima Centauri b and the famous TRAPPIST-1 system. Honestly, even if there were truly habitable planets among them, you would see them consisting of a desert hemisphere and a glacial hemisphere, and then oases near the morning twilight line. That might be kinda spectacular.
Kepler-452b.
Dubbed Earth's cousin, Kepler-452b orbits a star similar to our Sun. However, its larger size and uncertain atmosphere could mean it's more of a distant relative. The habitability of Kepler-452b hinges on several factors, including its atmospheric conditions and the existence of water, that remain largely unknown. You ask me why I draw them as habitable planets? No, I didn't. You think they are habitable, so you see them habitable. It's not me, it's you. You see, when you dive into them, you find all kinds of major problems. But on the surface, they can just claim themselves habitable worlds with a nice orbit. So it's dumb to look at exoplanets within the habitable zone to choose which planet to go on an interstellar trip, otherwise only to find more Mars and Venus, or even something wilder. Maybe in Earth 2.0, except there is 21% of oxygen and 79% of ammonia in the air.
Wouldn't that be cool?
Maybe. I don't know. But you might still ask.
I know not everyone in the habitable zone is going to be habitable, but there have to be some that are indeed selected by this nasty universe and waiting to be found as Earth alternatives, isn't it?
Turns out, you are correct. However, the real habitable exoplanets might only account for a percentage smaller than you can imagine. In fact, according to a new study, Earth-like planets with about 30% of their surface covered by exposed continental land may make up only 1% of rocky worlds and stars' habitable zones. Instead, roughly 80% of potentially habitable worlds are completely dominated by land, and about 20% are purely ocean worlds. The results indicate that Earth's ratio of land to sea, 1 to 3, is finely balanced, and that for most planets, this ratio can easily tip over into mostly land or mostly sea. Earth reached these conditions about 2.5 billion years ago, at the end of the Archean, and our planet found the delicate balance we live in today. However, over billions of years, even Earth's fine balance is unstable, although we don't notice it because the rates of change are small. Why the ratio of land to sea can be a potential problem? Well, ocean-dominated planets with less than 10% land would likely be warm, with moist atmospheres and tropical climates, whereas land-dominated worlds with less than 30% of their surfaces covered in ocean would be colder, drier, and harsher than their ocean-dominated counterparts. On these land-dominated planets, cold deserts would stretch across the landmasses, and vast glaciers and ice sheets would be common. And we haven't even considered the atmosphere yet. If we were to sift through atmospheres of normal composition and pressures unlike those of Mars and Venus, the percentage would only be even less than 1%. Oh, by the way, did you know that Earth-sized planets are not really a common type of planet in the universe? Planets you are more likely to find anywhere except our own solar system are super-Earths. Like, 5 times more massive than our Earth. And since these planets are massive enough, they might not even be rocky planets. So in the end, you shouldn't take those habitable planets too seriously, they are just some mirage. It's easy to get caught up in the excitement of discovering potential new homes for humanity, but we must remember to approach such findings with caution and skepticism. Otherwise, you would run into an Earth 2.0 except there is 21% of oxygen and 79% of ammonia in the air in the end. Alright, this is my new approach to my video format. I know I was making something totally different every time, but eventually, this will become a series, I think. Thank you for your continued support and feedback. It means a lot to me as I strive to improve and create content that you enjoy. Stay tuned for more exciting videos in the future. And I will see you in next.